Welcome to Positive Atheism English Channel, sixth part of Atheistic Philosophy. The formulation of natural law is another discipline in understanding. Imagination correlates events, ties up the loose ends, and presents a synthetic understanding in the form of a law. The concept of natural law is an aid to understanding as it facilitates a habit of thinking. The laws of the cycle of seasons help us to plan our work. But closer scrutiny reveals that the laws are not inherent in the events of the world. They are our interpretation of our experiences. When fresh facts come to light, our fresh insight develops with experience, the form of law changes with new interpretation. Though Dalton regarded the atom as the smallest indivisible particle and named it as such, the discovery of the phenomenon of radioactivity changed the concept of atom. Also, no natural law applies wholly to an event in all respects. The concurrence is an approximation. Over longer ranges, the differences become more and more appreciable, just as the present timings of the rising of the sun do vary with old calculations. Not that the old calculations were wrong, but the happening is varying. So, a natural law expresses the present average of our experiences. We fit in the understanding into the event instead of the law determining the event. When we visit a bookshop, we fit our foot into a shoe rather than the shoemaker fashioning the shoe to the size of our foot. Whereas these consider natural laws as definite and irrevocable and submit themselves to them, atheists know themselves to be the authors of the laws and use the laws as aids. The laws are revised whenever they are repugnant to new situation. Surrender to the law breeds conservatism, while mastery over them helps a progressive understanding by the reassessment of the position at every stage. The theory of evolution is a convenient natural law to understand the relation of things around us. It dispenses with the need to believe in a creator to understand events and things. Within limited and observable lengths, a fair amount of evolution can be safely assumed. But when we carry it to the extreme of nebula and primordial matter, we commit the same mistake as postulating the first cause. Patches of earth may look fairly flat. But putting the patches together, it cannot be surmised that the whole earth is flat. The natural law of evolution is a useful aid, but a trap for the unwary. The concept of design is a corollary of the belief in natural laws. Evidently, the argument of design bristles with obvious contradictions. A design presupposes a designer with a purpose. As the designer is often supposed to be a god and God is supposed to be loving and merciful, what consistency is there between love and the existence of evil? If war, fraud and poverty, untouchability, racial discrimination, infant mortality, cancer, pest and famine were to be parts of design, the designer should be punished for wickedness rather than worshipped for love and mercy. In the face of evil, the proposition of design poses the dilemma that divinity is not all good or else it is not all powerful. If God were both good and powerful, there should be no evil. If evil were a test and temptation, it betrays the recognition of freedom to the individual to yield to or to resist temptation and thereby contradicts the almightiness of divinity. Also, it presents divinity as a mischievous and malevolent spirit that play cruel pranks with its own child. In fact, there is no design. At best, the concept of design is wishful thinking of the modern man, because the primitive people understood the world analogically and anthropomorphously. They thought that a man-like spirit inhabited every phenomenon. With the touch of modernity, the wishful thinking of a civilized theist is similar to that of his primitive ancestor. The modern theist is accustomed to plan, design, law, and order in his daily life. So in wishful thinking, he reads order and design in it his world. In practice, however, the concept of design has turned out into a clever ruse to reconcile honest theists to their miserable lot with faith in a divine purpose. Atheism dismisses the assumption of design and awakens the mass of people to a sense of equality. It stirs them up to rebellion against political, economic, and social evils. An important aspect of theistic philosophy is the concept of the universe as a law-bound cosmos and all phenomena, including man, as parts of it. The notion is consistent with the theistic attitude of surrender, since man becomes the part of the universe and subordinate to the whole. Though religious men and materialists differ in the understanding of the structure and dynamic of the universe, both agree in the existence of the universe and thereby deny freedom to the individual. But the recognition of the freedom of individual interprets the universe in different way. Atheists regard the universe as a collective concept like that of a flock. When several birds sit together, they give the idea of flock. But when each bird flies away in her own way, the flock disappears and it does not exist any longer. Yet each bird exists by itself. So, the reality lies with the existence of the individual bird, but not with the existence of the flock. Similarly, the universe as such does not exist. Only the several phenomena and the individual of human beings exist. Their existence too is not permanent. Each one changes in form and content. Nevertheless, the collection of phenomena and the individuals goes by the name of the universe. Further, the individualities of each one render the universe a chaos and not a cosmos. The sum total of individualities gives the impression of an order of a natural law. Several irregular grains of sand thrown together give the shape of a regular conical heap. The regularity is not pre-existent in the heap, but the relation between irregular grains produces a regular pattern, namely the heap, which is but a collection of sand grains. Likewise, the universe is a collection of individuals. Each individual is an entity by himself, but the universe neither exists nor is an entity by itself except a concept of imagination. Whereas theistic thinking proceeds from universe to man, atheistic understanding preserves the freedom of individual, while atheistic understanding proceeds from man to universe. The preeminence of man in atheistic understanding preserves the freedom of the individual, while theistic understanding, which considered man a part of the universe, jeopardized the freedom. Thank you.
For more videos, please subscribe to this channel, Positive Atheism, and activate the bell icon.